Yes.
Hello, everyone. I'm from HackerRank. And in HackerRank, earlier we had a big, fat, monolithic app. All of the front-end projects were residing on that particular app. So it was kind of hurting us. And then we decided we should move from that monolithic app to a more modular and manageable infrastructure. So today I'll be sharing that experience, how we did that. But before we start, I just like to know our audience. So how many of you had breakfast morning? Okay, cool. Yeah, do a long stretching. Yeah. And how many of you have a single repo for all of your projects? Okay. How many of you use multiple repositories for different projects? Nice. And how many of you don't have any repositories at all? Okay. So yeah, I think we have a good number of people who have multiple repositories, so you guys can relate things. About me, I'm Sudhansu. I work at HackerRank. I do a lot of open source projects. Currently, I'm working on a very interesting project. It's a UI library, something similar to React. You should check that out. And if you have any question on JavaScript front-end architecture or any design patterns, you can just ask me on Twitter. So the agenda of this talk is to tell the pain point we were having with the monolithic app and why we had a need to move away from it. Also, how we did that, and how we fine-tuned the overall process. So the first major reason we had to move away from monolithic app was to reduce the overall app complexity. So all, as I mentioned, all our front-end projects were part of one monolithic repo. And for a developer, if he's working on a feature, it was like a lot of context he had to keep in his mind, and it was not productive for him. And also, because everything were staying together, the code base was same for all the projects, so there was a lot of coupling happening between different modules, and because of which, if someone is working on a feature part, and if you have to make an improvement on a core component, that was becoming part of a feature development. So that was kind of creating a bottleneck between teams, and it was creating a kind of cross-team dependency. So let's say one guy from a team need code, like updates of a core component from the other team, but he have to wait for that feature to get completely pushed. The other reason was that we wanted a separate deployment for all of our products. So we have a different products. We have HackerRank for community, we have HackerRank for enterprise, for candidate, code pair, and a few more. And all of them have different stability threshold, I would say. So basically, the amount of stable we have to keep a particular product is a little bit different across products. So we can push fast on our HackerRank community, we can break things there, but we can't do the same thing for our enterprise app. Also because in enterprise application, you do pushes in like 2 weeks or 3 weeks, you make a different version. For community, we do that daily thing. So we need to have a different release cycle for each of our projects. So that was one requirement. And let's say if you are updating any core components, we want that to happen only for one product. We don't want that to happen on all the products. So release of making a release for one product should not affect any other products. And not just new features. This was happening with bugs as well. So we were producing some bug on one product and it was spreading across all of our products. and that is not a very good position to be in. Your community site is down, and then because of that, your enterprise is down, which is not good. So we wanted a separate deployment for all of our products. And it was also becoming a bottleneck for us to innovate. By that, I mean, if you want to try out new things for a part of a product, it's a little bit hard. I'll give an example. So we tried, we wanted to experiment with Jest. Earlier we had Mocha with Karma, Chai, Sinon, and all. And now there was a way for that monolithic app, either we set up two different testing pipeline and we keep them both. So that would increase our Travis build time, that would increase our production build times. Developer might get confused, if he's working on a feature which is spread across different files, then he might get confused whether he has to write on Jest or whether he has to write on Mocha. So apart from that, enhancing a few part is also a little bit difficult. So if you want a feature improvement on one product, and if that works well with that product, then you want to bring it on other products. It's a little bit hard because everything shares same code base. You can't actually do it. You can, but it's not very straightforward. So we knew that we have to move away from monolithic app. And the first thing we did was to evaluate our different options. So first we thought we already have mono repo, so why not just use submodules into that? But it was solving few problems for us, but not all the problems. So our different part of a product have a different type of a build pipeline, so modules have to be built differently. Our products have to be built differently. They deploy, they get deployed differently. And monorepo doesn't solve that very well. Also, the main reason why we wanted to move away from monolithic app was to create a mind shift. So for a developer, when he's working on something, if he's working on a core pieces, he should work that isolated. But with a monorepo, that mind shift would not happen. People would, again, form a little bit coupling between different modules. They will work on core component along with the feature. So our best choice was breaking our monorepo into multiple repos. And we went ahead with that. The second thing we did was to list down all the different pieces of our application. So earlier, our repo looked something like this. There were a lot of other products, but just to mention, so let's say we have HackerRank for community, we have HackerRank for work, which is enterprise, and then both of those apps would share some common things, our component library, utilities, common configurations, scripts, etc. So we decided to break this, we decided to categorize this into two types. One apps, which will be all the products, and the other will be modules. So products, because products have a different deployment, they have a different build pipeline, so this categorization was required. Modules are something which would be added on apps, and apps will be entry points for all the products. So after the split, we had a plan that it would look something like this. So we'll have different apps, HackerRank for community, enterprise, and candidate, and then we will have modules, all our common modules as a separate repositories. So some modules to mention on that, like we splitted our icon library as a separate repo, where it has a build tool which create, earlier it used to create a font icons through SVG files, and now we create SVG icon components. So that is separated, and then we have an atomic UI component library, which we call UI kit. We have common utilities library, which we call HR util. Then we keep all our build related scripts, dev scripts on HR scripts. And then there is a shared component, which is, so UI kit is more of an atomic components. A shared component is something like components which is used across products, like a pricing view or something. And but they are very specific to HackerRank. And there were a couple of other modules as well, smaller modules, which I have not mentioned yet. But while we were breaking all our applications and modules, we wanted to keep our code style uniform across all the modules. So a developer switching between different repos, he should not feel that he has come to some other company itself. So to keep the code style uniform, we created presets which are very specific to HackerRank standards. So we created a style-in preset for our CSS files. So we keep all the CSS rules there. We created ESLint presets for JavaScript, and we created bevel presets. So everyone uses the same level of JavaScript features across all the modules and apps. Then we had to create build pipelines for our module. So for publishing any module, so we treated our all module as a, like a normal NPM packages. So as a you import a third party package, you'd import your HackerRank module in the same way, and you will give the same like a module name with a version name on your package JSON. We initially thought of using NPM private registry for it, but then because it has its own credential managing system, and we were already doing that on GitHub, we didn't wanted to do that on two different platforms. So we decided to have a registry, have a self-hosted registry. So we used Nexus repository manager for that. And with Nexus repository, we just have to create the two tokens, read token and write token. And with each of our module, we would keep read tokens. And we'll keep write tokens on the Travis part. So developer can't push it directly from the publish release will happen always through Travis. Now we are looking into GitHub package registry, because we already manage the credentials on GitHub. So I think a GitHub package registry will also work for us. We are exploring into that. So the overall Nexus repository looks something like this. So whenever you publish a module, it comes under Nexus registry hosted part. And that happens through Travis. And on our applications, if you add that on a package JSON, so whenever you do yarn install or npm install, first it will come on Nexus registry, check if it is already available from the hosted. If it is not available, then it will try to fetch it from npm registry. And once, so it acts as a proxy between npm registry, and then it will keep that cached. So next time if you do yarn install, it will directly return from npm registry instead of fetching from Nexus registry instead of fetching from npm registry. So we wanted to automate deployment of these modules, and we did that through Travis. So we followed a simple rules, like we make a release whenever there is a version bump. So you can do alpha version bumps on your feature branch. And for stable releases, you have to do stable version bump on the master. So whenever the version bumps happens, Travis will trigger a release. It will also auto-generate a doc if we have any doc script on that particular repo, and it will push it to S3 in a version-based system. So you will have docs for every version of that specific module. And after publishing, after releasing, we send a release notification on Slack. So everyone is notified that something is available for that module, and they can start using that particular module. After setting up a pipeline, we went ahead separating our modules, and we did that it once, and we moved our module one by one. So first we moved UI icon, then we moved UI kit, and so on. And with every move, we improved our tooling, we improved our build pipeline based on the learning of the previous move. So this is very important, like we should move things one by one. So we have a learning across the process, and we improve things across the process. So now we have moved almost all of our modules. Now we are in a phase of moving separating all of our applications. While doing that, we saw that a lot of infrastructure code is similar between all the apps. So we decided to separate out that infrastructure, front-end infrastructure, as a node module. So that infrastructure would contain the isomorphic infrastructure we have built that is very custom to our use case, the tooling part, the dev tooling part, and the application layer. And there are a lot of code on this infrastructure part. So this went as a separate module which app can use, and in application repository, we will only have the application code. It will not have any common code. Then right now we are in phase of separating out our apps. This multi-repo architecture is working very well for us. There were few hiccups with multi-repo architecture. To mention on them was like, how do we manage cross dependencies across projects, and how we do version upgrades across all the modules and apps. And the second one was, how do we have the same level of productivity we had with a single repo architecture, monolithic app. So how we maintain the same thing, or how we can improve that local development part. So for managing cross dependency, we strongly followed semantic versioning. So for a module, if there is any API changes or if there is any breaking changes, we would do a major version bump. If there is any API addition which doesn't affect the older APIs, then we would do a minor version bump. And if it is just a bug fix, then we'll do a patch version bump. And in our modules, we would not keep things on dependencies. We will keep things as a dev dependencies and peer dependencies. We'll keep only those things as a dependencies which are very specific to that particular module. If a dependency is shared across app and module, we'll keep it as a peer dependency on modules and keep that as a dependency on application. The reason for that was we wanted to keep package version source of truth on our app level. So if you want to upgrade a version of any package, whether our own module or third party module, you have to just do it on application packages, and you don't have to do it across product. And whenever there is a major version bump on the application, because you have we define peer dependency with caret symbol, so it will start throwing error that peer dependency doesn't match. So at that point of time, we upgrade our specific module to have the latest version of that particular package. And for solving the local deployment with the monolithic app, we would just code things and we see everything at once, right? Now, when we have a multiple repo, the main pain point was like, what if you want to do some changes on UIKit module and you want to see how it looks on your application? Would you publish a new version, alpha version for UIKit, and then add that alpha version on your application, then test it out? This will become a very long process. So the first thing we tried out was just giving like a local path on packages and doing yarn install. So what you have to do is like you do build on your specific module, and then you give that a relative path on your packages, and when you do yarn install, the it will load, it will fetch data from your local system, not from the registry. So that would work, but every time, even on this, every time you have to see the changes, you have to build on your module, and you have to do yarn install on your application. The second thing we tried was yarn linking. It is similar to npm link. So what it does is it creates a symlink between node modules and actual folder. So now you don't have to do yarn install on your application. But still, you have to do the build part. So you write on source file and you build a distribution file out of it, either lib or ES modules. And in your application product, you'll be pointing to those lib folders or ES modules. So that was also like a little bit of work. So we created our own open source solution to solve all this problem, which we have already open sourced. This is called package bind. And with this, so it uses a Babel plugin called module resolver. And with module resolver, what you can do is like, you can give a relative path for your library. So in an app, if I want to work on a local UIKit, I just give a relative path of my local folder, and I will directly point to the source path. This by itself doesn't work very well. So what package bind does is you just have to wrap your Babel config on package bind, and it will return a new config with a resolver function, which will resolve your files specific to, if it is getting loaded by UIKit, it will resolve it properly. If it is getting loaded by application, it will resolve differently. It will handle all the peer dependencies. It will handle if you have given alias on your modules. It will also handle cases when you have defined some aliases on presets. So it handles a lot of things. With that, what you get is like, you don't need to run build on each of your alias repo. The cross repo development can happen with hot reloading. You make change on one repo and it will be reflected on the another repo. And this is a big pain point on multi-repo architecture. That's why people move to monorepo with some tooling like Lerner and all. But with that, you don't have to move your monorepo, multi-repo on a monorepo. So I have a quick demo for it. So I have two projects. This is like a demo project. Let me just run this. Let me start. So this is a simple number formatting. This is again model which I have open sourced. This is a simple input form. What we want is like use some custom text field with that. So let's say we want to use text field from material UI. Now let's say there is no, because the input is being rendered by number format, we have to implement something on number format itself. We can't just wrap text field here. So let's say we added a new property here called custom input, and we provide that as a text field. We change our bevel config, so we give a relative path for React number format. We use package bind to optimize the bevel config. Now, you can see like this got affected. So you can make some changes on your other repo. Sorry, I had this change. Okay. I have to restart because I changed npm. Okay. Now let's implement custom input in our number format repository. So the prop was custom input. And we say take input equal to custom input if it is there, or just say input string. Use that instead of input. Now we see here still it's there. When we save on our other repo, we can see that got reflected here. So now we have a text field instead of normal input items. So you can use it on app or your like a third party module, and that will work flawlessly. So key takeaways I want you guys to take from this talk is, because the architectural change takes a lot of time. So if you are planning to move away from monolithic app, if you want to, if you want monorepo or multi-repo, first list down what are the challenges you are facing with monolithic app. And then choose your option wisely. Then list down all the different pieces first. Create a plan like how you'll move things one by one. And also choose the right toolings for it, or if the toolings are not available, build the toolings. But make sure the developer experience is not getting affected by the architectural change. It should improve, it should not degrade. So you have to make sure that. And at the end, don't break everything at once. Move things one by one. So you learn on the process. With that, thank you. You can follow me on Twitter, GitHub. Any questions, or do we have?
Thanks, Sudhanshu. Any questions from the audience? I mean, you should have either understood everything or you didn't understand anything.
Yeah. All of you didn't understand anything. Raise your hand.
I mean, do you have any questions that you want to ask? I mean, you can feel free. I can see some interest, but not necessarily asking questions.
Yeah. So this was not a complete all engineering effort we put on this. We did it slowly, one by one. It took around 6 months, but there was like a we were moving only one module at a time, and that's why it took a long time. If you put a more engineering effort, we could have done it much faster. But that's a way I would suggest, like, give it time, move one by one, so you don't break everything at once.
Anybody else with the question? Okay, thanks Sudhanshu, thanks for that.